So I work for a company called WSO2.Telco. I think you've got the introduction. Let me go to the next slide. Right, so it's a joint venture between Asiata, which is quite an innovative telco, which is also the parent company of Sri Lanka's very own Dialog, Asiata, and also WSO2, the company that we all love. So what we do is we build products that satisfies all those little buzzwords that you see in the blue color box down there. So we focus on telco, software for telcos, which are quite modular, that can be customized very easily, and also is cloud ready, because now that's the trend that everybody is following. And also we are the only co-branded OEM partner for WSO2. What we tend to achieve, now we focus on mainly on telco software. So a little bit, I've been at a telco for most of my career. Telcos are quite strong and powerful, and they have a lot of they're sitting on a gold mine. So if you remember the movie Hobbit, you see there's a big dragon, Smaug. It's a bit like that. They're sitting on a gold mine, but not the most agile or not the most enthusiastic people to do anything about it. What we try to do is make them quite agile and get them up to speed so they can easily work with the OTT players who are very robust nowadays. So it's like, you know, a bit of yoga for telcos. Right, so we're going to talk about identity crisis. Not the type when you see a slightly bald guy trying to grow a beard, not that. This is actually an existing problem. It's an age-old problem, identity. Everybody's trying to verify identity. There's always been different methods of identity from history itself. But now more than ever, there's a need to prove your identity and to have a verified identity, not only as a customer, but also service providers who are providing a service needs to be identified properly. So you see here some very interesting statistics. If we go to a new website and we try to use it, we always tend to use Google or Facebook Connect or whatever method that's already available so that we can log in and avoid the lengthy registration process. And also usernames, I think Johan also mentioned earlier, there's quite a bit of drawbacks there. And also there are other attacks or other threats that you're vulnerable to, like there could be a man in the middle or somebody intercepting your data. There have been other methods to try to solve this, like you get a OTP or SMS pin on your phone, or there's another device that you can plug in. But this is always something else that you need to carry or have. But the thing is, if you think about it, every one of you in this room have something unique identity with you all. That's actually a mobile number, because that's globally unique already. And your phone, continuously, even now, is authenticating with the operator, who knows who you are already. So in a sense, you're actually verified and authenticated right now, already. So that's the base of the product, or the idea or concept Mobile Connect is, which is trying to bind that already authenticated identity that you have with your service provider to verify you online or to a service. So apart from just authenticating you, that opens up the channel or the path to a lot of other services, because authentication is just the first step of anything that you do. Sorry, there's a program called Mobile Connect Accelerator, which can transform a mobile operator into identity provider. Now, if you look at this diagram, there's a WSO2Telco MCX solution. This is something we can deploy at an operator, and the operator can instantly become an identity provider. There'll be adapters that would connect to the operator's backend, their subsystems, to provide authentication mechanisms like SMS OTPs or USSD or SIM-based authentication. And also, the product can give them the possibility to authenticate people, attribute sharing, and all the other services that you need. So what would happen is, if there's a service provider who's hosting a service, wants to authenticate somebody, the service provider would initially call an exchange, an API exchange, where they can actually detect who the operator of this particular customer is. So if I'm trying to log in, and I click on Mobile Connect, I would be transferred to an API exchange where it would detect who my operator is. and then forward it to the operator who would actually verify me using my mobile phone, and then tell the service provider, okay, this is this person trying to log in. There's another added advantage to it. Now, I wouldn't necessarily want to be known as Charit to every service provider, because I would want to be anonymous. And also, if there are multiple services provided by one service provider, I still wouldn't want to be known by the same synonym to all of those applications either. So there's another functionality that Mobile Connect can provide, that is anonymity for the customer for a service provider. So I'll be anonymous across all the service providers. Now, this security, or this level of security, is achieved through a level of assurance and authenticators. Now, the higher the level of assurance, you get higher security. And this is achieved through something called an authenticator. Now, an authenticator could be a simple SMS that's sent to your phone, or it could be a pop-up message on your phone that you click on, or you enter a PIN, or it could be an Android app, Apple app, something like that. So you can see a set of examples here. I think people are most familiar with an SMS OTP that you get on your phone when you try to do a transaction. So we built on top of the WSO2's identity server, so we get all the goodness of that. And I think in the previous presentation, you would have seen that there were some extension points that we can use. So what we have done is we've built on top of those extension points. So our authenticators, if you see the orange color box on to your right, those are the authenticators that we provide. And what we've done is we've built an authenticator framework so that any operator who has their own custom authenticators can very easily plug an authenticator onto Mobile Connect solution that they have. I'm just going to run through a quick some video so you can have a look at how this actually works. I was planning on doing a live demo, but I couldn't do that, so I just grabbed some videos right now on my PC. Let's see. Right. Okay, so this is a demo site. And now I'm trying to log into this website. And I see the option of using Mobile Connect, so I'm going to use that. And again, so usually you wouldn't get that, but yeah, so that's just for a demo. Now I'm going to enter my my mobile number. Now at this point, I'm getting a message saying that I'm not registered on the system. So I'm going to click yes, I want to register. Now I'm getting a notification on my phone, which I respond saying yes, I want to log in. Now I'm actually registered and also logged into the website. That's all it takes. You don't have to fill lengthy forms or anything like that. Right, so this is another authenticator that we're going to demonstrate. This is a smartphone application. So now it's triggering an application on my phone. At this point, I'm using a fingerprint scanner here. Right, there should be one more, yeah. That's the same video, I guess. Yes. That's the same login. Okay. Right now, initially the registration, I think it only asked for me to just click on a message on my phone and it registered. Now you might think there's a problem with that because that's not secure. Anybody can get to your device and do that, but that's also the lowest level of security. So what level of security that's going to be applied when you're registering actually depends on the requirement of the service provider. So if the service provider says, I'm OK with that, then right. So it depends on the service provider's requirement. For example, if you just want to browse a browse an online magazine and you just want to see the customization or the channels that you subscribe to, maybe that doesn't require that much of security. Just identifying that it is you and you have the device with you would be enough. But if you try to do a transaction, purchase something or get, subscribe to a new channel, then you would need a higher level of authentication or security. Then you would go to something like the smartphone app or another mechanism where you get a push message on your phone where you actually have to enter a PIN. If you go to something like that, then there's another process where you'll have to set up a challenge question like where were you born, things like that, and you answer that. And then you create an online profile and then you do the registration. But what I demonstrated here is the most basic level of registration. Right. And there's another, okay, so here I'm showing you LOA 2 and LOA 3. So the base of mobile connect is actually something that you have and something that you know. So something you have is your mobile phone, and something that you know is either your a PIN that you enter or even the fingerprint. So that's because that's your identity. So if you have a look at this diagram here, this is what happened when I was showing that demo. So this is the flow that it goes through. Initially, if you see the screen where I enter my mobile number, at that point it would be deciding which operator I need to go to, which operator can actually authenticate me. So depending on my mobile number, it would decide I should be sent to operator A or B or C. So then I'll be forwarded to that, and that would be the WSO2.Telco ID gateway. And then it would trigger the authenticator based on the level of assurance that the service provider is requesting. The initial registration demo that you saw was LOA2, which is the most basic level of security. And then it would verify me through my mobile phone and transfer me back, and then I'm registered and logged in. There's a much more simpler way of registering also or login called header enrichment. Now, remember I said earlier that we are already always being authenticated onto the network. Now, if I browse a website or use a service, my operator actually knows that I'm going through this website. So what I can do is I can whitelist a certain URL on the operator that could inject a mobile number onto the header. That's called header enrichment. So if I'm browsing a newspaper, maybe I can if I'm that service provider, I can ask the operator to whitelist my URL so I can get the customer's number. So in this case, it's actually been whitelisted at mobile connect solution. So that through that header, we can identify who the customer is, and if the service provider is requesting for the lowest level of security, you won't get anything, you can just directly log in, just because you're actually using a mobile phone and browsing on it. It's usually referred to as an on-net scenario, where because you're on the network, and if you go off network, then there'll be a push or something onto your phone. We actually have use cases in Sri Lanka. If you try to log into any of these websites, they already use Mobile Connect. This is actually the very first Mobile Connect rollout in the world, the commercial implementation. So these are done by different operators, but still the single same way of login, you can use the same way of login, regardless of the operator that you belong to. Anybody belonging to any operator can log into those websites. If you basically have a mobile phone, you can use Mobile Connect to log in. We actually have another use case in India. We've deployed a hub in India for Mobile Connect. Now, that's a bit different than the setup that we see in Sri Lanka. Now, we have multiple operators in India who are actually connected to this hub. Some of them have APIs that are exposed, and some of them have their legacy systems. So those need to be translated into a manner that we can integrate into the Mobile Connect gateway. Now, if you worked with an operator, you would know that operators have their own protocols for SMS, would work on SMPP. USSD also sometimes work on SMPP, or they have their proprietary protocols for that. Now, the problem is then you need to either transform everything onto a single thing, or you need to write different adapters to do that. So what we do there is we've deployed the telco hub, which can actually integrate and expose everything on a RESTful manner. So what the ID gateway has to deal with is a set of REST APIs to talk with all the operators. The other benefit is, now, Also, here you would need to decide when the ID gateway wants to authenticate a certain customer, which operator to talk to. In this case, that mediation is actually happening at the telco hub. So based on a set of rules, it would decide this authentication request should go to operator one or operator two. So there's a protocol converter that sits at the telco hub, which can convert all those protocols onto REST, and then that's integrated onto the telco hub. So the way this is done is it can be deployed onto any operator, and with a few adapters that you write or deploy, it can talk with any operator's backend. Now, this whole engagement, this is so most of the telco operators in India or all the major operators are on board this. And this whole engagement from scratch to set up for them to have a live production ready mobile connect solution took 6 weeks. Just 6 weeks. And 1/6 of the world already has mobile connect. Right. Now, this is interesting. Now, why would an operator actually want to give a mobile identity solution? If you think about it, they really don't have anything in it. Authenticating somebody, that's not going to make them any money. But the thing is, they're quite strong in that because they actually know a lot about you. If you think about it, they actually probably know a lot about you than yourself. They know what you're browsing, they know what websites you're visiting to, who you're talking with, who you're sending SMS to, everything is there. There's a lot of data, but they're also very good at protecting that data. And identity is always a stepping stone onto something else. You verify yourself and you log into a system or a service or something that you want to consume something or do something there. So that's where actually the money is. So if you look at the solution that we showed earlier, the hub, which is capable of a lot more than identity, so there's a monetization part for it. Now, if I'm an operator and I want to deploy a solution, I want to be an IDP, I also would want to make some money out of it. So one way of doing it is actually monetizing the APIs itself, the APIs that you expose for authentication. Those APIs could be monetized depending on the number of times you authenticate a user. That can be a chargeable event for the service provider. Or you give that for free, and then you charge the rest of it. Once you're authenticated, through that channel, that service provider can charge something onto the customer's bill and sell a solution. That's another benefit that you get. So those are other ways of monetizing this whole engagement. The other thing that we do is we also have another hub deployed for RCIATA. Now, that's connecting all RCIATA's operators onto one hub. So they have one single API platform that any developer can or service provider can access and contact any of their operators. So all the operators' APIs are available on that single hub. Through a single API, you can contact with their 220 million customers. So that's acceleration of MNO service creations, because that allows them, a service provider who wants to build a solution with a telco wouldn't have to know their proprietary protocols, but they can just rather go and use a very simple REST API and talk with all of those service provider, those APIs. Multi-MNO APIs now, there are a set of common APIs that service providers expose. For example, IdeaMart in Sri Lanka is exposing, doing that exactly. They're using our software. They're using that, they're exposing SMS, location-based services, direct operator billing, and USSD. Now, those are standard APIs that most of the operators expose. So we have standard adapters that you can deploy on an operator and expose these services. And an operator, if it's like a group like RCIATA, they can become a hub. So they have multi-operator capable APIs by deploying this. And it's quite easy for the developer's point of view. They can create services very easily. If you take IdeaMart, most of the customers are, or the developers are students who are making like good applications and getting a very good income off that.